Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to day three of Open Apereo 2015. We've got a good morning for you today. Remember the beadwork, U-Portal and Xerti state of the project presentations in this room. I want to thank all our sponsors, folks on the tables outside, but I want to make a special thanks to Encast for streaming the events in this room and showing us what Opencast can do. Thanks, Hank. We are about partnerships. That's one of the things we do. We are well aware that we can't move the earth on our own, so we work with other organizations with similar values and similar missions. Our keynote speech this morning is from one of our partners, the Open Source Initiative, manages stewardship of open source licenses and also undertakes a range of advocacy and community roles. You'll hear or probably have seen the expression 100% open around a lot this conference. It seems to be developing as a kind of tagline of ours. I'm proud of that. But I'd like you to welcome now Pat Masson, the General Manager of the Open Source Initiative, who's going to explore the real meaning of open for us. Thanks, Pat.
Thank you, everyone. I noticed that the conference tagline is a new era of open, and that's what I'd like to sort of focus on, because I'm sort of questioning what the heck open even means anymore. And it's to Ian's point about 100% open, I think that strikes right to what a lot of people have. Apparently, I'm not close enough to the mic. I was a hockey coach, so I would think I could bellow loud enough that everyone would hear me. So I'd like to talk about the ambiguity around open as it becomes ubiquitous, especially within higher education. Before that, I would definitely like to thank the community, the folks that organized the conference. Thank you to Apereo for inviting the OSI. As Ian said, it's the partnerships that we have that really enable our work, and understanding the community out there is so important to know what to advocate for. But most importantly, I want to thank all of you who are open source contributors, participants, developers, who actually create the community that allows open source to succeed. So I think you all deserve your own round of applause, even if you drank all last night, and if it's too loud. So it's all good news, right? Open source, I don't think anyone can contest anymore the success of open source. The recent ninth annual Future of Open Source survey shows staggering adoption rates and numbers of projects and so on. Participation by organizations, not just as end users, but also as contributors back to projects. You can see the growth of Apereo's project as an indication of that. The incubation program that Apereo is doing is fantastic for helping new projects mature and gain adoption and awareness across the education space. These are just random stats about Linux, Android, whatever you want. Just go out there and Google and look, and you can quickly find plenty of graphs that show an upward and growing trend in the adoption of open source. The EdTech and technology media is happy to constantly tout the growth of open source in technology, and they're also recognizing the open source ethos, that set of practices and principles that are now applying beyond technology and software, but include organizational practices. The CEO of Red Hat just put out a book, I think last week or so, about the open organization. And it really came to a head for me with the recent net neutrality debate that happened. Both sides of the argument were talking about how they wanted to protect the open internet. So how can that be? I guarantee you, I have an idea of what I think the open internet is. And I'm wondering how both sides could do this. And we're seeing all sorts of use of open source, especially in education, open source learning, open source textbooks. There's initiatives out there on campuses and within states for open source textbooks. Open source courses, here's a clever little use of flipping the letters there. MOOCs have one of the O's as open. There's open source hardware, open source robotics, which is sort of like hardware. Open source drones for fun and profit. That might be extortion, depending on whose backyard they're looking into. I don't know. Open source washing machines. Now, I'm not mocking any of these projects. This is actually a great project to help in third world countries who don't have access to either electricity or water, or ready access to water. There's open source design, where you can get your open source furniture, open source fashion, open source photography, open source beehives, which yield open source seeds that bring open source recipes that you can enjoy with a cool open source cola and afterwards have an open source beer. And this is an email I just got the other day about someone wanting to know if it's trademark infringement to use the term open source with their new cider project. Open source street lamps made out of 2-liter bottles, which is great to take the open source cola and beer that you just drank and now you can make an open source light out of it. Open source Shakespeare, open source culture, open source music and art. Open source, come on people, get up and dance for our open source festival. We have open source religion, open source government. Are you wondering what open source means yet? And you know what? It's open source everything, even with a manifesto. So it's got to be legit. So open source does have a history before the OSI, open source intelligence. And oddly, it's kind of funny when somebody just looks at OSI and then sends us an email with their conspiracy theory about the OSI being involved in intelligence activity, which it is, but not this OSI. And it's actually used, just quickly, there's an interesting story about using open source intelligence to track a woman who was believed to be involved with ISIS as she tweeted across the Middle East. And they found her, and they found her, I know that much. And open source intelligence actually is referenced as far back as World War II and used by the Office of Special Services, and they would use information that was readily available to assess bomb damage based on the price of produce and things. So if they bombed the train or the bridge, prices went up, they'd know that they were having an impact. And of course, Benjamin Franklin didn't patent his bifocals and other inventions because he thought they were so important that they should be publicly available. So that's an idea of freely exchanging information and ideas. Brian Mulroney, Prime Minister of Canada, I'll sort of tweak his saying, if everything is open source, then nothing is open source. And Bruce Perens, who is one of the founders of the OSI and also the developer of the open source definition, sort of says, well, you know, if you're a rebel and it's successful, there's nothing to rebel against anymore. So we can't let the fact that we initially were fighting traditional proprietary software development and licensing, and now that we're successful, still looking to pick a fight. So real quickly, the OSI is, as Ian mentioned, a nonprofit organization, membership-based, that was founded in 1998. You heard on Monday David talk about that meeting that got together about open source, where the open source concept was first developed for software, and then the open content idea came from. This was that meeting. The term was coined by Christine Peterson, and it's based on the movement, the Unix environment, the hacker movement, GNU Free Software Foundation, the Debian Free Software Guidelines, which all led to the open source definition, which the OSI is the internationally recognized steward of. So there is a definition for open source. Bruce Perens was the primary author for that, along with Eric Raymond. And here it is. It's much longer, believe me. It is a document that the OSI uses to develop licenses or to approve licenses. Most recently approved the UPL from Oracle as an open source license. And these are the 10 most popular in alphabetical. I don't know, no one knows what the actual most popular license is out there. So that's what we're primarily known for. But in our world, in the software world, the world we all live in, the open source world, open source is, this is The only definition that there's for open source is that software that's distributed with any OSI-approved license. So that's a fundamental thing to understand when you are looking at open source software and communities. So if you're developing software and you want to distribute it and take advantage of the software freedom of open source licenses, you want to apply an OSI-certified license. And there's several tools that I'll talk about later that can help you do that. And if you're, like I just said, interested in adopting or using or contributing to an open source project, you want to make sure that you find one that's carrying or distributed with an OSI-approved license. And it's not just us that's saying it. These are just some of the examples of organizations that have signed affiliation agreements with us that recognize the OSI's role as a global nexus of trust in protecting and promoting open source software. Apereo on there. Thank you very much, Apereo Foundation, for your support. So I won't go into this slide, but it's just sort of the standard who we work with, end users, developers, advocates, projects and communities, Linux Foundation, WordPress, Drupal, those sorts of things, business and government. And as I said, we're nonprofit member-based, meaning that our elections and our governance is done through, our governance is done through a member-elected board, five of which are elected by individual members, five of which are elected by the affiliate members like Apereo Foundation, and then as the GM, I serve as the ex officio member. So if you want to become a member, we'd be glad to have you. It's $40 a year. Here's my sales pitch. And if that's too much, you can tell us I don't want to pay, and we'll just give you a membership anyway. We're supported by corporate sponsors that have no role in our governance. And those include Google, HP, IBM. I shouldn't start naming them because then when I don't name one, I'll be in trouble. So a lot of very generous corporations that have an interest in open source. And as far as the advocacy goes, for example, here are some of the things we work on. As you may know, the IRS recently came down on nonprofits status. OpenStack was an example that wasn't given 501c3 status, I believe. And so we're now working with the IRS to better understand open source projects and also with organizations to develop resources so they can position themselves when they apply for nonprofit status better. We're working on voting in California for open source software to be used in election software. We're working in New York State to get a tax credit for open source developers who contribute code to projects. We filed Friends of the Court briefs to the Supreme Court around the recent patent case, the Google API case, and so on. So lots of government activity. And just recently, we announced that we are extending our affiliate membership to higher education. So if you're at an institution of higher education and would like to become an affiliate member, and we sponsor all sorts of activities around open source. If you're interested, if you're introducing open source and need support on your campus, we do that. It comes at a very expensive price of $0, so there should be no cost barrier for that. And the idea is to create a cohort of open source users, developers, contributors within higher ed that can help one another and help the larger open source community work together to grow. Oops. So I guess, can anyone guess what I guess?
Everything is awesome.
Yeah, there you go. Everything is awesome. But unfortunately, there are some new issues that have come about with our success. So that was the end of my sales pitch. Hopefully it wasn't too bad. And I want to talk about the current issues facing open source. And probably to start off with is, what is... Even the term we use now, is it open source software, open source, open, openness? We're all using these terms sort of interchangeably, and I think everyone often has a different idea of what they mean, a different set of expectations associated with its use, and the affordances that something labeled with open source, whatever it might be, has. So Larry Rosen, who was the general counsel for the OSI, wrote a great book. Almost a textbook. He's an attorney and a law professor. And you can see there, I don't know if you can't see it in the bottom. Dina, I apologize. She's here. She told me some of my slides are too small. But in the corner there, it talks about what are the tenets behind open source. And we saw this again with David on Monday, David Wiley, with the five R's, the open content definition and the open software definition from the Free Software Foundation. And there's these themes that are through there. But these alone aren't enough just to say, for example, you can reuse or redistribute or modify the code. Well, what if I put in a provision that once you modify it, you have to tell all of the authors previously that contributed to that? Would that still be open source? Right, and I touched this on already, the tie between open content and open source, and the tie between the open definition for and open source. And we're starting again to get around the ethos to see Red Hat here is talking about the term open source refers to things that are publicly accessible and crowdsourced, if you will. And again, is that specific enough? For a while, there was discussion about trademarking the term open source. But you can't do that because, as I already mentioned, open source intelligence. So nobody would actually give anyone a registered trademark. However, and now we've come to this sort of problem. Right? Do people recognize these things? The dark beverage is it's a Coke. Those aren't tissues, those are Kleenexes. Hockey fans will recognize the ice resurfacing machine as the Zamboni. That picture's been photoshopped, right? There's Ian delivering a PowerPoint, right? We're gonna Google it, not search for it. And now open source has the same thing. Right? It's just open source. So rather than defining, perhaps it's better to identify the qualities, the principles, and practices of open source. And then you can take this and apply it to different projects within different sectors, whether that's content or data or whatever it might be, using these shared ideals against practices within the community. So it used to be hackers were like, you know, the guys at the top there. These sort of folks who worked in garage, that's actually Richard Stallman, Eric Raymond, Linus Torvald. And now open source is perceived as a benchmark for your internet startup, right? On the below, I typed in CEO open source startup, and you get all these nice pictures of people who are involved in the latest startup. Oh, here's the slide. Hold on.
Well, don't just sit there, do something. Did you use open source code to save time and the virus was hidden in it?
Maybe.
Rookie mistake.
So here's an example of some of the FUD that's still out there. This is actually from Disney's Shake It Up series. I'm at one time impressed that they even know that open source exists, but disappointed in their portrayal. So the first FUD movement was ties back to the Halloween documents. I won't get into it, but folks will recognize on the left the issues here. Security issues, support issues, quality issues, higher cost issues. And those were dismissed as we saw the Department of Defense became a huge adopter. And while they didn't vouch for the security, the fact that they're using it for security sort of raises that question of, oh, it must be pretty good if the Department of Defense thinks it's okay. Later on in 2013, Coventry scan showed that its open source review has equal amount of defects. Open source is it better by default just because it's open source, but you can't say it's any worse now. So that myth has been busted. What about support? Who do you call at 2:00 in the morning? Well, I think just the number of organizations that work with the Apereo Foundation and projects highlight that support is readily available, busted. What about quality? Well, the same future of open source survey and other Gartner and various other reports point to quality as actually being a reason for many of the companies and organizations adopting open source. That's been busted. And total cost of ownership. Again, that's often usually the first thing that people look at is the cost savings associated with open source and only realize other benefits once they get involved. So again, I would argue that has been busted, and I'm happy to talk afterwards with anyone who doesn't think this is the case. And interesting, the Microsoft's Halloween documents that sort of set the table for all of this. Microsoft actually applied for an open source license in 2007 and was granted one. And now, Microsoft loves Linux and open source. In fact, they've released the .NET framework and Visual Basic as open source. Their CEO, I don't know his name, he's revealed how successful their open source projects and exploration has been. So much so that just recently, Microsoft's announced that it's definitely possible that Windows might become open source. So I think that all has shown that the traditional FUD movement of it not being high quality, it's expensive, blah, blah, blah. And in fact, the last month I was at Linux Fest Northwest, and Microsoft was everywhere. I saw a Microsoft logo on a Linux Penguin. I don't know why, I sort of slipped into bizarro world. And many of the police, or the organizations that were originally developed to help you keep from getting open source snuck into your code, that rogue developer who's going to go somewhere and pull in an open source nugget somewhere, and then you're going to be susceptible to all sorts of GPL violations because it's viral and all this stuff. Well, now that same company is helping organizations adopt open source. And to be full disclosure, Black Duck is an open source, an OSI sponsor. So what better evidence is there that times have changed when those who once were working against the movement are now supporting it? So we have the current FUD. And this is actually parents' food. But I found this and I thought it was funny. It's more meaty. So our FUD today is more meaty. But to be fair, I looked up on Netcraft, and they're running a completely open source website. So I thought that was ironic. So the issues today are about licensing and patents. And a lot of this is confusion and misuse of, and I was just talking to Dr. Chuck about this, the end user license agreement associated often with source code that's released with an open source license, and sort of issues around indemnification. And here's the example I was going to use, GeoGebra. It's an online math tool that's released with the GPL. However, they have an end user license agreement, clearly stating it's open source. However, if you're a commercial organization, you cannot use it, and you have to get a different license. I'm looking at John to see if he falls off his chair. And so that sort of confusion for a lot of end users is like, well, wait a minute, I thought this was open source, but now this organization is telling me, and I was just informed of another one that's doing something very similar. And in fact, there's a lot. And there is real necessity to make sure that the licenses that are applied to software are truly followed, that people aren't violating the terms of the licenses. We want to ensure that the software freedom that they provide continues. And there's actually a lawsuit, the first one, underway in Germany, where a developer for the Linux kernel is being represented by the Software Freedom Conservancy and the Free Software Foundation about GPL violation. And those two parties aren't really as bitterly engaged as you might think. If you talk to both sides, they're actually interested in getting a court ruling on the status of a lot of the issues that affect, you know, what are perceived as the viral aspect of the GPL and so on, where there's a clear line as defined by courts, so that there's actually would help the entire movement. Organizations would understand what is covered in the license and the extent of the license. So this is not a negative thing in effect, but it leads people to think, oh my gosh, if I do something wrong, nobody really understands it, I'm going to get sued. And now a big movement has been indemnification, where organizations that produce or distribute open source software commercially are offering the indemnification. There's law out there, there's attorneys groups that are saying you have to have this. And again, it's causing a lot of consternation, kerfuffle. Where's Brian? That's the third time now I've used that word. The next issue in the FUD of today is around security. And you might remember, the basic idea is that the many eyeballs aspect, it doesn't work. It's been proven not to work. And issues around Heartbleed and Logstack, Network Time Protocol, and so on are evidence of this. But in reality, it's not that the theory or the idea or the ideal of many eyeballs makes all bugs shallow is wrong. It's just there's not enough eyeballs. Right, if you use SSL, you should be contributing in some way to this. If you're every, you know, I thought it was funny that the watch, the Apple Watch? What is it? Right? iWatch? Is that what it's called? The Apple's thing? I'm not getting nuts. Right? This is coming out, and everyone uses NTP, but your watch won't be able to tell time anymore. Right? Because the network time protocol is not being supported at the level it should be. All right? So one issue is that there's not enough people engaged in looking at it. There's not enough eyeballs. Another issue is as private companies get more involved in supporting open source, they're routing all the bugs and the security issues and the fixes through their organization. It's not a meritocracy. It's not an open community. And therefore, they're deciding what's happening. So these are organizational issues. It's not a problem with open source, but it's adding to the FUD out there that's, oh, it's not secure. Well, it's not secure because we don't have enough people engaged that we could have if people truly had the principles behind open source at interest. This is also from the future of open source software survey, and it says that 55% of those companies that report using open source don't have business processes and practices in place to manage their software portfolio, their open source software portfolio. Again, giving you the idea back to the old days of these people working in their basement where she just pushes out code whenever she feels like it and nobody checks it and so on and so forth. But if you look at the research by Scott Ambler, who comes at this from the project management side of things, he actually reports back in 2013 that 84% of teams use ad hoc development measures. So I would argue, and 50% of those traditional and ad hoc software projects are unsuccessful, I would argue by getting involved with an open source project that has to manage community in a large open ecosystem, you actually get better development practices because you have to comply with those that the open source project has set up to manage such a diverse and dynamic environment. And that's why it's only 55% according to the open source survey, but 84% of no practice in the other survey, in the Ambler survey. And all of these things are really exposing the new market that's been developed because of the success of open source. So this is actually a positive that companies have now realized, hey, open source is a dominant feature within the development environment of businesses and universities and so on and government, and they need help in understanding what this is. I'm just disappointed that they choose to use scare tactics to promote it. So here are some of the things they do. Audit. Okay, what are all the licenses associated with the code you might be using? Are they compatible? Do you have governance practices in case? Do you understand the licensing? All those things are important. They're just not terrifying. And in fact, the OSI does this. This is one of our projects led by Joseph Potvin, who was helped the Canadian government in their adoption of open source, and he was working with several businesses that were beginning to include open source development practices internally, just the practices, but also participating in open source projects. And their project managers weren't used to not being able to just decide what's going to happen, right? They controlled the resources traditionally within an organization. And now how do I engage with the community when I can't assign resources, time, money, and so on? And so the Flow syllabus, the Free Libre Open Works, is a set of resources that anyone can use for download and use, and it touches on everything from IP transfer, project management, HR issues, legal issues, all sorts of things. It's free and available, and in fact, we'll even come out and do a training or whatever to help you do it. And it costs, again, $0. I sound like this knife, right? How much would you pay for this knife? But wait, there's more. So the next issue here is I want to talk about is open source has become a profile economy. And what I mean by that is that a lot of the folks in the projects have now become focused on individuals. And we're seeing a lot of hype and so on around the people who are involved in the projects rather than what they're doing in the projects. And one of the common things now, and I know this is probably popular and I see it in higher ed all the time about how companies are, how folks should use GitHub as their resume and their portfolio. And that's really leading to a situation where people are beginning to hype themselves. You're seeing these rock stars and ninjas and so on, where folks are touting their associations rather than their relying on their contributions and the merit of the work that they've done. Here's one of my, I don't know if you can read this. When someone calls me a rock star as a developer, I get drunk and trash their work cube. So, and this is a site from Macy's where you can go online and order your outfit to become a hipster developer or a young CEO. And these are actual pictures of people who, and now I know the hipster hacker is a fake Twitter account, but I just, you know. But I think you recognize the other people on the right. And we're going to talk about the other guy there in a minute. And there's an app now where you can create your own killer startup, you know, or whatever, you know, come on. And this is a survey that came out, why you participate. I want to enhance my professional status and the reputation of the community. So, anyone know who this is? Brian Beldorf? Who is that? John? Exactly, right? How about this person? Anyone? No, he's not the rock star, but he is the number one committer to the Apache project. Okay, what about this for everyone? This is for the OER folks in the room. Come on. Right. You know who this is? You can probably guess now. Yeah, there you go. Look at that guy. What's his job? I mean, 892,000 edits? How about this guy? Yeah. There he is. How about this guy? Is he here? Is he here? Number one contributor. All right, and thank you, David, for this comment. I will read the side, David, if he's here. Don't ever make the mistake of thinking that you can design something better than what you get from ruthless, massively parallel, trial and error with a feedback cycle. That's giving your intelligence way too much credit. And this goes back to the many eyeballs, and it's actually given a knowledge best set of beta testers and co-developers. So you need this community. Not only will your problems be identified, and it might be somebody else who finds the problem and fixes, or someone else then who found the problem who fixes the problem. And this is a very dangerous myth out there now, that you have to be a rock star, you have to be deeply engaged in the community, you have to have years of development programs. John Lewis just did a session yesterday about how to get new people involved in the project. And the OSI gets questions all the time from new developers and who want to get involved in projects, but they feel intimidated and they can't get involved. How welcoming is that community that's going to allow for new folks to discover issues and opportunities? Which leads us to this problem. Again, because we've got these big egos, we've got too many starters of projects, and not enough joiners. How different really is your unique project that warrants creating a whole new project? And do you understand the burdens that's going to be placed on you to get that project to mature? So for example, how many open source learning management systems do you think, I'm not going to say are out there, do you think I could find? Yes, how much? How many? Anyone? 25. Any other guesses? More or less? 40. 236. Now you're going to tell me that there's 236 key differentials that make all these open source learning management projects. Would the Sakai Foundation not like to have maybe 50 of the communities involved here in helping? Now I can understand if there's architectural or technology differences or pedagogical differences that are driving these. So you might have 20. But do you need 236? And this leads to another question about getting communities to work together, projects to work together. Alan Clark of SUSE and OpenStack talked about how do we get more, and the most obvious example is the Linux distributions, how do we get more of these communities working together? Deb Nicholson, who has a great background working with a variety of projects, OpenHatch, Free Software Foundation, and so on, talks about not just including developers. You need marketing folks, communications folks, fundraising folks, people, again, who don't feel that they're part of the community because they're not the rock star developer. You know, oh, you're not that important. You only set up the conference that brings in the funding, that finds the sponsors and so on, that allows the people to do their work. Oh, you only go out and share the business process or the business benefits and find new adopters. You only do the training. You only do the documentation. You're not the rock star. You have to change that attitude. And again, this is counter. This whole idea of the rock star developer is counter to way back. Anyone read The Cathedral Bazaar? I hope you do. You should. It's the seminal work. It started the open source movement, or at least defined it and coalesced it. A hacker cultural taboo, and interesting, back when this was written, it's saying it's decaying, against admitting that ego or external validation are involved in one's motivation, right? So there was this taboo against getting up there and saying, I'm so wonderful, and look what I'm doing, and I'm the best, and all my work, therefore, must be the best, and you don't deserve. Hopefully I can share. Oh, I won't, never mind. This Carl Fogel, former RSI board director, who wrote a great book on producing open source software, and his line is, the contribution trumps the contributor. Right? That's the meritocracy that we should have. And the OSI is helping in trying to create a scoring system that allow organizations to understand how what the maturity level is in terms of a lot of these principles and practices. One of them is the Open Index, which identifies specific sort of a maturity model that allows you to assess your organization and how accepting and or how open. I'm trying to not use that word because I just said it's back or it's misunderstood. Next, open source. Again, David stole my thunder on this one. I don't get the chuckle that he did on this, but I added the etymology there so you can at least see where it came from. And we get all sorts, often by Twitter. This is, if you can't read it, somebody letting us know, the open source organization, our Twitter account, know that they have a new no government license, to which we quickly responded, well, that violates the OSD by discriminating against people, groups, and fields and endeavor. And then they're like, oh, no, we don't really, it's not really open source. This is another example. My favorite is Jim Jagielski, who has one. It's from an article, I think it was in, I don't remember, but a significant magazine, you can look it up, saying that you don't need a license to be open source. I guess you just call it open source. Here's an a company in Germany that promotes their software as open source. Cable is free, open source, decentralized. But if you look in the, it doesn't comply with the Free Software Foundation or the OSI's definition of open source. There's some ambiguity. And then this is their tagline, please don't trust us. Guess what, I don't. So at least they're honest in their untrustiness. We're working, as I said, with California to come up with open source software and use in voting systems. And one of the organizations that's trying to help has submitted a license that's not been approved by the OSI. But they say their lawyers looked at the OSD and they think it complies. Well, when we looked at it, this is Allison Randall, our new president, and we quickly discovered that we would not have identified this as an open source license and would have not approved it. So just because you call yourself open source doesn't mean it is, and you should be aware of that as both consumers of open source and also as contributors to open source. So we have this sort of openness or open-ish category. One of these is open core. And so open core is where an organization releases a small, tantalizing tidbit of functionality as open source and then builds a proprietary model around it. This is Simon Phipps, our former president, and talking about why it's bad for you, because it basically creates the same vendor lock-in that open source, for one of the reasons why open source was developed, was to avoid that vendor lock-in, right? So if you're not involved, yeah, you can modify that fundamental kernel of software, but all the functionality that you rely on, the integration with other applications or whatever it might be, isn't available to you, especially if they're hosting it. There's really no practical difference between a proprietary software license that covers the entire architecture versus one that just locks you in anyway because all the really good stuff is under proprietary license. And so again, here's the core or the takeaway for open core, denying you those software freedoms by locking you in with a specific vendor. And I understand there's several examples that I could mention that you all are aware of within the higher ed space. Josh is smiling. Commercial ownership, taking that open core model slightly farther. Understanding the governance and who owns what within an open source project. Open source licenses are not a release of copyright. They're just a license of the copyright holder. You still own that software. And when that software is owned by one person and not a foundation, and not the foundation represented by a member-elected board, it's a higher risk because that one person can go off and sell it. So that's an important consideration, again, as both a contributor and an end user, to understand who owns the copyright of the software, who owns the license. Here's a recent example of FoundationDB purchased by Apple. One day, people go in to continue their forking and pull requests and wiki discussions and so on, and the whole GitHub repository is now closed. Here's another example of a project that was open source but then sold. And they actually positioned it as a great new sponsor that's taking on all the development responsibility. But you're out of luck. Finally, there's open washing here. I think most people are familiar with this term. It's really the use of open and open source as a marketing and tool, promotional tool. Michelle Thorne of the Mozilla Webmaker program, I believe, coined it. Anonabox is an example. It was on Kickstarter. It got kicked off Kickstarter for a lot of reasons, but one of them was sort of this fraudulent use of open source. This is my favorite.
Come on inside. I have something new to show you. Now it's my pleasure to present to you plans for our next product, the Yola tablet. At the moment, it's just a dream, but we want to make it a reality. We want the tablet to be people-powered by the Yola community. You tell us what you want, and we'll do everything we can to make it happen. Your tablet is powered by open-source software called the Sailfish. The Yola tablet's display is as high-end as you'll find today.
Now watch this real quick. Can you see that? You probably can't see that. I should have blown it up. It looks a lot like our logo, too. So needless to say, as you can probably guess, they raised $2.5 million, by the way. Did you catch that? $2.5 million in an Indiegogo campaign.
Come on inside.
Open source Sailfish. Huge amount of press. It was going to rival Android. The Russian government is looking at it so that they can avoid the NSA issues. All sorts of stuff going on. They love it. There's the problem. First of all, if you look at the end user license agreement, well, you can't do anything with it. Cannot allow such development to make it better. We encourage you to make it better, but we can't allow it. You can't modify it. All right. Well, we encourage you. You're expressly prohibited from copying. You can't use it. All right. Well, okay. And our goal of the Sailfish is to someday, well, they don't say that. Our goal with the Sailfish OS is to develop an open source operating system. So in reality, there's no license associated with this right now. And they're getting all sorts of, rightly so, pushback from their people who join the community when they get their contributor license agreement and their development kit about why can't you make this open source, even though it was touted open washing as open source. So I got so mad I wrote a blog talking about this. And the issues here are, one, the gross misrepresentation of open source and using it as a marketing tool. But all those people who gave $2.5 million, who were expecting to participate and then couldn't, right? If your institution got on board, and your institution probably wouldn't be working through a crowdfunding site, but began giving money to an organization that then either sells that intellectual property or changes its model so that you can't participate, that'd be a scary thing, all while promoting it as open source. So how do we respond? Well, in that case, we hit normally what we do is we have a nice letter developed by our fine legal representatives at DLA Piper that we send folks. Obviously, you can't read it. And if they use the logo or if they use open source software, we can go after them as a violating our trademarks, especially with the logos and so on. And we tell them legally they're not allowed to do that. So what they'll do is they'll change it to crowdsourced or some other thing, and they'll take down our logo. And then what we do is we enlist the community, and that's why our affiliate membership is so important. Because nothing helps better when Sailfish OS, when you call up the folks at Google and the Android project, and you call up the web services folks, or the Firefox folks and the Mozilla folks, and let them know that this is happening. So we use the community to help inform and align folks when we feel they're doing a violation. So here's just some examples. Clouds, the cloud is it, right? That's all, right? Everyone loves a cloud. Dr. Chuck loves the clouds. It's difficult to even talk about the cloud because, again, it's a bit of an ambiguous term. Rosalind Metz has probably given me I've seen the best demonstration of the cloud and what it is. So it's on EDUCAUSE. These slides are available, so the links are there. So just so we're on the same page, Stefano Zaccarelli, who's Zach, is also on the board, recently gave a presentation at Libre Planet. And the concerns about the cloud, what's happening is the open source software that used to be readily accessible for us to edit, giving us the freedom to inspect the code, to modify the code, to redistribute the code, that's not available a lot of times in the cloud environment. Now, if you're standing up, essentially, I think I have the next slide here. Nope, sorry. I guess if I forgot to add it, my bad. But so if you look at the different types of clouds, so yes, if you're just standing up a traditional sort of co-location environment where there's this handing you hardware and you're installing anything you want on it, okay, that's good. You can still manage your open source software in that environment. It becomes more difficult as you go to the other extreme where it's the software as a service. And even if they're running an OpenStack or an open source infrastructure, and they're running open source software, but you don't have access, administrative and development access to that anymore, you're giving up some of those software freedoms. So it's a slippery slope that you need to be careful of, that you might not actually have the access to the source code and all the benefits of open source software as you hand those off to another organization. Whoops, wrong way. And finally, the post-open source movement, of course, right? Anyone heard of this? A couple people. So the younger hips crowd is like, we can't tell us what to do. We'll do whatever we want. And the cool kids aren't using open source. And here's an actual Reddit comment. Hello, everyone. I'm currently working on a website and wants to make it open source. Is there anything else I need other than GitHub? You're good. Just put that stuff on GitHub. That's what all the cool kids are doing, right? Google code, summer code, shut down. All right, so just throw it up there. I blocked the bad word there, or I tried to. Right? I'm like, just take it, use it. And in fact, if you look at the GitHub repositories, only about less than 20, I think it's 18%, currently have a license assigned to them. So the cool kids are just putting their stuff up there and sharing it. Same with Stack Exchange. How many people have either posted a question or posted a response that includes code in Stack Exchange? All right? Dr. Chuck, you are a cool kid, so that makes sense. But what's the problem? The default, at least for US and EU countries, is it's all rights reserved. So unless you sign a license to it, nobody can use it. And that's probably not a big issue for the majority of just sort of messing around, tinkering stuff on there. But you're never going to build a community if folks can't use the software. They can't copy it. They can't fork it. They can't download it. They can't run it. They can't modify it. They can't contribute to it. Right? So this is Richard Fontana. He's also on the OSI board. He's Red Hat's patent and licensing attorney. And that causes an organizational barrier in the growth of your project that most folks aren't aware of. But fortunately, the OSI to the Rexu, we're working with GitHub to create they now have the license chooser. By default, it goes to MIT. If you don't select anything, you can explicitly say you don't want anything. There's also TLDR legal, too long didn't read. Legal, it helps you to identify licenses and the properties. It's an OSI project. And also the Linux Foundation and the OSI is a software package data exchange project that helps trace identify the licenses associated with different projects. So to sum up here, how do we identify open source? Again, Simon Phipps offers sort of an open by rule. Can you look at an open source community or project and identify these qualities? And by doing so, you should be able to identify what is open source anyway. So an open meritocratic oligarchy. So it's a meritocracy, but it's still you have, it might sound odd, an elite group, but that elite group that's making decision is elected by the community. Right, so it's community folks who have been identified to manage the decision making, because a democracy is just too much to get a yes vote on everything. And so compare foundations versus corporations, member-led versus self-appointed leaders. Right, and the benefits come from and engages a variety of co-developers and participants. There's universal community rules. You don't have different sets of rules. So if you are this type of organization, you have to use this license and you have to behave this way and you can commit and contribute this way. If you're another type of organization, there's another one. Everything's transparent. You can self-organize. You can see what's out there and say, I want to do this, I want to get involved with this, and you don't have barriers to undertaking activities of your interest. And there's more than just coders. There's a variety of folks that are involved. And the activities are discoverable. I can go out there and say, you know, I'm interested in doing documentation or quality assurance, whatever it is. There's a role that I can discover, and that's welcoming. And it's a community equal license. I touched on this already. But that's not only the outbound licensing. It's also how content is. There's a lot of issues with copyright assignment and contributor license agreements, right? And ideally, those should be able to reside, if the folks want to, with that individual contributor. You don't have to assign that over to the community. Now, that takes a lot more overhead, perhaps, but those are the ideal organizations. And if it is going to be contributed, it's contributed to a foundation, a nonprofit, some sort of organization that is made up of diverse individuals, again, elected by the community, that not one person can sell off the intellectual property. And that if the community doesn't like them, they can be voted out or thrown out. And so here's sort of that, a little bit of what I talked about earlier about the maturity model that we're working on. So the communication, you're open, communicating everything, telling people what you're doing, why you're doing it, how you're doing it, which leads to transparency that allows for self-organizing groups to come together around projects of interest where they can collaborate. Decisions are made on evidence-based, not ego or who you are. Remember, it's the contribution, not the contributor, which leads to the meritocracy. So theoretically, you can't get to that meritocracy without going through those stages. Whoops, wrong way. So thank you. If you want more information, there's a table outside that I've been sitting at. You can go to our website. You can email OSI at Open Source. You can email me personally. We have memberships, so both affiliate memberships and individual memberships. If you're interested in getting your institution involved, it doesn't have to be at the top level. If you're in the English department and the instructional design department or the IT department and you want to join, you can do that. We have a method to do that. And again, the goal of our affiliates is to raise awareness and adoption and promote and protect open source and create communities where we can all help each other with the adoption and growth and success of open source. So thank you very much. And I think we might have time for questions. And I'll say now, I am not a lawyer, and I will not advise on what license you should assign to your favorite project.
Thanks, Pat. That was a great talk. So from a point of view of both a product manager of an open source project and a CEO of a commercial company, there's always that balance between making the project as open as possible, but also finding a way that you can build a business around it in a way that doesn't violate any of the open source principles. And I mean, Sakai is a good example of that, as many open source projects. Any thoughts from your perspective when a company says, I want to be successful in open source, but I still need to build a business?
Right, so that's one of the issues around open source is developing businesses. The OS I just worked with Concordia University, the business school there. I forget the name of the project, but the result was 31 different open source business models, not only on how they're beneficial to the company, but also how they affect the project themselves. So it's a great resource. Email me if you want it. I think I already shared it with somebody here. But that's exactly right. How do you create authenticity in the open source project without being hindered by the label of the big corporate bad person that is out there? So ideally what organizations are doing are working with nonprofit foundations. That's why the IRS project is so important with us. So that way, the authority of the project is within that foundation. And it might very well be true that there's one company or corporation that's most involved in the development. I mean, look at the Linux environment, Linux Foundation, right? There's definitely large corporations that are involved with that. So what's important is that the company is honest and transparent about its role, and the foundation, again, is equal to all participants. If they happen to be getting a lot of support from one organization, one company for a while, that doesn't mean they limit participation from others. And so those are what I outlined. Try to give you some references and some ideas about how to assess the authenticity of the open source project. And what I would look for, and I would suggest you look for, is that separation and management by a nonprofit foundation that is authentically engaged in the open by rule concepts that I talked about.
Great talk, Pat. Maybe I'm in the post-open source movement. There are things that I'm not scared of that I was scared of 10 years ago in terms of being trying to sort of manage and be particular and picky and about open source details. And one of the things that I'm slowly becoming less afraid of is mixing licenses in a source tree. And so, you know, we're terrified of GPL, right? It's just kind of like, here we're kind of an Apache group, we would touch GPL and we would be immediately vaporized somehow by just touching GPL the wrong way. But what I just can't get my head around is why it's so dangerous to have a GitHub repository with one file in it that's Apache and one file in it that's GPL, and then sort of zip those two things up and that's my product. Now, I can't represent that the zip file is Apache because the GPL is viral, but I can't see why it means that I have to go and replace the Apache licensed file in the repository with a GPL license because its neighbors are GPL licensed. So viral means the zip file can't be called Apache, but I don't have to change the license in every other file in my repository. And so I don't understand why we're so afraid of mixing these licenses and thinking they're viral. I'm not sure they're viral at all, other than the fact you can't represent that the ultimate zip file is Apache licensed by when you stick one thing in it. So are you seeing these kinds of things? And then the sort of follow-on question is, I'm starting to see projects that don't replace the copyright in individual contributions, and they simply talk about a license. So Apache does this. You just see, oh, this file's copyright, you know, Sarah from Netflix, and this copy is file copyright Bob from Google. And the whole thing is just licensed by Apache as compared to taking out all those copyrights and saying they're all copyright Apache. So these two things seem as though it's kind of, we're just getting really much more relaxed about this whole thing and not trying to clean these source trees up and make them look pristine with the exact same license in every single file.
Right, so license compatibility is the first sort of issue, right? And I think that's definitely at the heart of the law lawsuit that's going on in Germany, right? Getting these clear lines of demarcation and understanding. You know, I can't tell you in every case and how that software might be distributed, you know, how it's, you know, because that's the fundamental thing here, is when the software is distributed. That's the trigger to when the licenses take on, except for the AGPL, which is if you're running it. So I think it's important to be sensitive. You know, when you distribute that software, what's the relationship between the Apache code and the GPL code? You know, that's going to vary. And that's where the entanglement occurs. And to be honest, that is confusing. So the OSI, you know, has extended its mission to to begin to address these. So the TLDR legal is an example where, again, because it's sadly what we say when we get these types of questions is we can't give you legal advice, contact your attorney, because it's going to be different for every specific thing. So you should be aware of licensing compatibility. You shouldn't fear it. Most often it's elevated to a level that doesn't need to be that panic, and it's hindering the open source movement, but it is legitimate. You do have to respect the intent, and you should respect the intent, and you have to obey the law of the license. So, any other questions?
Hi, Pat. Right
there's here. A voice. God, is that you? Where's?
Hi, Pat. It's only Laura Gettler.
Oh, underneath the light. Sorry.
From the University of Notre Dame. The University of Notre Dame became an Apereo Foundation member because the values of open source are consistent with us as an institution. The values that... Thank you. And I just wanted to stand up and say thank you for opening up the OSI affiliate program to higher ed, because I think it's a no-brainer for all of us in the room.
Well, I hope we'll have lots of folks joining. Again, we support, as an affiliate member, you can come to us with projects, and if it's something that's going to help the entire community, we will support that, fund it, whatever at whatever level it needs to be, if we think it will help. It's a great way to extend and collect resources to help you with your activities, so thank you for recognizing the opportunity. That it? Well, thank you again, everyone, and enjoy the rest of your conference. And I'm at the table. I'm not selling anything, so. We are only giving things away. I always feel bad. People walk by us with, like, don't make eye contact. Turn my badge. Thank you, everyone.